Sitaram Yechury is General Secretary of CPI. Left played a crucial role in UPA-1 and was instrumental in formation of Manmohan Singh-led government. Sitaram spoke to WION on a number of issues. He said that the idea of a grand alliance before the polls is not feasible and better alternatives will emerge once results are out. He also spoke on the issue of foreign policy and West Bengal's Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee.
I'm joined by Sitaram Yechury, General Secretary of CPIM. Sir, thank you for making time for WION. And let me begin this edition of the interview with you by asking the question, is left in the same position to play the same critical role it played in 2004?
Well, I'll answer it in two parts. One, in terms of the numbers in parliamentary democracy, we are not in the same position as we were in 2004. But second part is that irrespective of that, I think in today's conditions, the left has a very critical role to play. And that is because of the being the voice of India's people's conscience, and also the values that we adhere to. That is something that Indian politics at today's conditions cannot ignore.
A lot of people have been talking about Grand Alliance, Third Front, but do you think it's a feasible idea, keeping in mind that you have multiple regional parties opposed to each other with different ideological view of the world?
Well, you see, again, in two parts. One is that we have to understand the nature and character of India as a country. Now, Indian politics, parliamentary democracy has always been dominated by different forces, different parties in different regions. To try and conceive a unity of all the opposition forces at the All India level is neither feasible nor advisable. So what happens, and we'll have to look at our own history. Whenever you had non-major political party governments, all of them, the fronts that formed those governments were formed post-election. Whether it was the case of Mr. V.P. Singh's government, whether it's the case of the 1996 United Front, Devagoda's government, that United Front was formed post-election. Or 2004, Dr. Manmohan Singh's government that lasted for 10 years, that UPA was formed post-elections.
So, but what about 1977?
1977, yeah, but that was again an election that took place after the fall of the Gujarat government.
1977, post-emergency.
Post-emergency again, post-emergency Janata Dal, which was the basic core. The arrangement of the government formation and the entire structure that evolved there was evolved post-election. You had various forces, part of the JP movement and the Janata Dal that came in. Now, that arrangement of who would constitute that government, or in fact, who would lead that government, there were so many disputes which finally had to be settled only post-election. So, 77, whether it was the Janata Party government, 89, whether it was the V.P. Singh government, 96, whether it was the Devagoda government, 2004, whether it was the Manmohan Singh government, on all occasions, the fronts that formed these governments were formed post-elections.
So basically,
and that is natural. And the second part, what I'm saying is that is natural. But what is happening today, like it happened earlier also, is that you will have unity of the opposition in regional places, state-wise. Like you see in UP today, the Samajwadi BSP coming together. That is the core around which all other forces will gather. Like in Bihar, with the RJD and other forces coming together, that will be the core. So the anti-BJP coalitions will be formed at the state levels. And that will converge post-election into an all-India formation.
So basically what you're saying is that the whole, the idea of concept of a grand alliance where all the regional parties can come together is not practical, not feasible.
Not feasible before the elections. After the elections, which regional party may join, which will not join. And we have the, let's say we don't believe in intellectual property rights, but we have the trademark of one conception called the outside support. So you'll have various categories. You'll have those joining the government. You'll have those who will be supporting this formation from the outside. But all this will be worked out only post-elections.
But sir, can we say that there's an ideological compatibility when it comes to Congress and left?
There's a, I don't think we can go up to the level of ideological compatibility, because ultimately what we seek is to replace the rule of the current class rule in our country, which is led by the big bourgeoisie in the Marxist terms, or the big capitalists and corporates. No, these are the interests that the Congress and the BJP also support and advance. So ideologically, they won't be there. But in today's conditions, in the immediate context, the fight against the communal forces, there, I think, which is essential today. I mean, we have come to the conclusion that it is imperative for India and Indian people to ensure that this government is ousted. To that limited objective, yes, there would be cooperation with all the forces who would want to achieve the same objective.
So, does it include leaders like Mamata Banerjee?
Well, Mamata Banerjee.
TMC?
No, as far as we are concerned, like let's say in Bengal, our slogan is oust Modi government to save India, oust Mamata government to save Bengal. And we think Mamata Banerjee and the BJP are playing politics in tandem.
Why do you say that?
Because they are going on a path of a competitive communalism. Have you ever seen the Trinamool Congress observe Shama Prasad Mukherjee birthday observations in Bengal before this? Never. But why is it happening today? They are competing for the same communal Hindutva vote bank, while at the same time, Mamata Banerjee pandering to minority fundamentalism.
More
the minority fundamentalism is pampered, the more the Hindu communalization gains. They feed on each other. Trinamool and BJP today are feeding on each other and trying to exhaust the space for any other force, left or democratic, in the state. It's a very dangerous development. But that is what is happening. So it's essential that both are defeated.
So you're saying that there can be no cooperation with TMC, even if it means to keep BJP out?
TMC, no. If to keep BJP out post-election, we'll see what is the situation that emerges. But right now, you take Tamil Nadu, for instance. The ruling AIDMK today is acting as the junior partner of the BJP. So in Tamil Nadu, our slogan would be to oust the Modi government to save India, to oust the AIDMK government to save Tamil Nadu.
So are we actually seeing emergence of two broad alliances against Bharatiya Janata Party, where the Congress and left cooperating with each other on one side with other parties, and Chandrasekhar Rao, Mamata Banerjee and other regional satraps, on the other side of the fence?
What does the Telangana Rashtriya Samiti have in Bengal? What does the Telugu Desam have in Bengal or Maharashtra or in Odisha or anywhere else? These are parties confined to their areas. So whatever they may form, that really doesn't gel into any common activity. So that is why I said all these calls, I mean, these are inevitably, they happen before the elections always. You'll be called for third friends, called for fourth friends, called for, all sorts of things. But eventually, it will be at the regional level, the cooperation between the major forces to defeat this communal forces. And that will lead up to an all-India formation subsequently.
Let me take you to a different subject. How do you evaluate Modi's neighborhood foreign policy? Has it worked in our favor?
Yeah, disaster. It's a disaster. Today, I mean, look at every single neighbor of ours. We have, take the largest neighbor, for instance, China. And with the entire eagerness to become a junior partner of USA in its global strategic thing, you have been sending signals to this partner that you are part of a US alliance which wants to contain China. Whatever may be US and China's thing, what is our interest? Our interest is better relations, which we publicly say, the government itself says, better relations with China, which both of us can grow. There's a synergy that can be built. Now that is being, negatively impacted. What is the meaning of India joining a joint naval exercise in, say, South China Seas, which ironically is called the Malabar exercises? You know where Malabar is, and you know where these exercises are. What is the point called doing, and with whom? With USA, with Japan, in South China Seas? What are the signals you're giving? One. Secondly, you look at Bangladesh, you look at Nepal. the anti-India fear, urban passions that are rising there. And Nepal, I mean, which we thought were actually, we were like twins. And then look at Maldives. Maldives, a country which was very, very closely tied to India and dependent. Now, your relations there were such Sri Lanka.
There's a bit of a course correction. Prime Minister Modi had this one-on-one meeting in Wuhan with the Chinese Premier.
I know, I'm noticing course correction. Not only one-on-one meeting in Wuhan with the Chinese Premier, but also the Sochi summit President Putin. And most importantly, and this is the contradiction which the government has to answer, India has signed the Shanghai Cooperation Organization declaration, where now we are committed to joint military exercises with all countries of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. That includes Pakistan. Joint military exercises with Pakistan will happen for the first time since independence. Now, with this entire Jammu Kashmir situation and the whole thing in the anti-Pakistan thing that has been rousing, and which they want to use for their communal polarization in India, and agreeing to hold joint military exercises, how does it gel? So I wouldn't say it's a course correction. What is happening is you entered a period of vacillations, where depending on one situation, you're taking one decision which doesn't gel with the overall philosophy or the direction that you have taken for the last 4 years. So that is again increasing the degree of uncertainty. Now, the OBOR, One Belt, One Road initiative of China, except for India and Bhutan, maybe. And I think Bhutan is also in double mind to accept it. They think there'll be a lot of infrastructural development. All other neighbors are part of it. And what is happening to the SAARC is virtually dysfunctional. So the relations with our neighbors has never seen such a fall that as we have seen in the last 4 years.
Is Rahul Gandhi an acceptable face? He's pretty junior to most of the leaders now.
These questions are not relevant now. They'll become relevant post-election.
Is he acceptable to Sitaram Yechury?
Post-election, we'll have to see. The same question was posed saying to Sitaram Yechury in 2004, saying all your life you've been fighting the economic policies of liberalization, what you call, of Dr. Manmohan Singh. How do you accept him as the Prime Minister? I said, yes, the Finance Minister of a Congress government is different from the Prime Minister of a coalition. And this coalition will go on the basis of a common minimum program. So that is what I say in India today. What India needs is not netas, but niti. Not leaders, but policies. It is the alternative policy direction of the new formation that will emerge post-election. That will determine.
At that point of time, I remember you were the bad boy of CPM because people would say that you have you're soft towards Congress. But in retrospect, sir, this question needs to be asked. Do you think that the support should have been withdrawn from Manmohan Singh? You did not benefit electorally.
Well, we have self-criticized ourselves on several counts. And one of the counts was that we failed to make the nuclear deal as a people's issue in that elections. And that cost us electorally. And secondly, also that we permitted the cementing of our political opponents coming together, like the Congress and the Trinamool in Bengal, which cost us at that point of time, the government there. So these things we have noted subsequently, saying that these were based on wrong calculations and these were our self-criticism.
But even your party coming together with the Congress and the Assembly did not work.
No, that point of the point was that we did not come together with them. There was some sort of an understanding on electoral thing. But the point that to create the confidence among the people that this can be the alternative, that was not sufficient and that didn't work.
Is it correct on my part to say that Sitaram Yechury will play the role of Harkishan Surjit in 2019?
Well, please don't make such comparisons because those are veterans, stalwarts from the freedom movement downwards with a wealth of experience. We will try, but the point is that it cannot really be compared. But it will definitely be our objective, which is our party Congress mandate to all of us, that we'll have to work for the ouster of this government by maximizing the anti-BJP votes in the country.
Is left in 2018-19, if there is a possibility of an anti-BJP government, in terms of number, will it still be averse of joining the government at the centre, or we will see a strategic shift, we'll find ministers from CPIM in the union cabinet?
That nothing can be said on that, but our party program is clear. He says if any such possibility of anything emerges at the centre, the central committee of the day will make an evaluation.
Your personal opinion, sir?
I mean, that it depends on what is the composition and what is the common minimum program. Because normally, that's why I said our
Jyoti Babu said that it was a historic blunder.
That was his.
One historic blunder has been made.
That was his assessment, you're right. But remember what I told you, our intellectual property right has always been outside support.
It can be changed also.
Well, the party, our party program permits. But this has been our historical tradition.
So thank you for making time for that. Thank you so much, sir.